That's weird. Probably that also gives
you. Good evening, everyone, and welcome to the City Council meeting for Monday, June 6, 2011, here in the Eileen Dondero Council, Foley Council Chambers. I'd like to call the meeting to order at this time. Welcome you all to City Hall and welcome our viewers on TV. And I would like to ask the city clerk to call the roll.
Mayor Farini.
Here.
Assistant Mayor Noveline Clayburgh.
Here.
Councilor Lister.
Here.
Councilor Hegmanis.
Here.
Councilor Spear.
Here.
Councilor Dwyer.
Here.
Councilor Coviello.
Here.
Councilor Kennedy.
Here.
Councilor Smith.
Here.
I'd like to ask Councilor Smith to lead us in a moment of silence, followed by the Pledge of Allegiance.
Please join me.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Our first item under presentations this evening is actually a resolution, and it is not typically under the, typically we would have it under the resolution portion of the agenda. But we'd need to move to suspend the rules so that we can address the National Guard Association of New Hampshire presentation this evening. Tonight, I would like to welcome William Silla from the National Guard Association of New Hampshire. We have a brief presentation. Welcome, Bill.
Good afternoon, councilors, mayors. I'm Lieutenant Bill Silla. I'm a resident of 323 Union Street here in town. I'm also a member of the New Hampshire Guard, and I'm speaking on behalf of our professional associations at the base. I have a brief about eight slide presentation I'd like to go over with you fine folks and gentle ladies, and after that I'm hoping I think I've already submitted it, a resolution of support for our base and for basing the KC-46 at Pease when it comes online.
Please proceed.
Real quick, we'll skip right down to slide 3 because I know you guys have a very full agenda tonight. Just a brief summary of some of the things we offer to the town. We employ 323 full-time members. 212 of those are GS civilians, pay scale, and 111 are in military status. Besides that, we also have a lot of traditional members that come in on weekends. They have other jobs in the community. There's roughly 1,087 total guard jobs. Besides that, we're one of only four guard units with an active duty component stationed for guard for tankers. Stationed our base, we're one of the first units to get it. We're kind of a model unit along those lines. Next, to talk just real quick about some of the educational benefits the base offers. I don't know if most people know that, but the National Guard of New Hampshire offers a tuition waiver to any state school. So if you're out there and you're thinking about sending your kid off to school and like the kid to stay local, maybe having a little difficulty getting a couple pennies together, the Guard offers a very good tuition waiver program. Also, another benefit after you serve longer is the GI Bill that we also think most people understand better. That you could use at any university in the country. But like I said, the tuition waiver is only inside for the state. Last, we offer lots of different training skills. We have an air traffic control squadron. We have a flight squadron, logistics training, budget, IT, law. So if you would like your child or anybody who's an adult looking for work, we have a lot of good jobs out at Pease. I'll talk a little bit about some of the economic impacts. I don't know if everybody realizes, but I don't know where it puts us as in the scope of local employers, but we do have $23 million in federal salary that we spend in the community every year. That's our annual budget. Our total operating budget, to include the money we bring in for hotel rooms when units come through transit to land at our base, it's about $80 million that gets put into the local economy. Lastly, construction. We've spent over $23 million in construction on our base of federal money that's come into the town as a local budget. And lastly, we do help the airport stay open 24/7. We have some joint use agreements with the airport where we have guardsmen filling positions that wouldn't normally be filled by the state. Allows the airfield to operate more efficiently. Next, talk a little bit about our current mission. Our current mission is global mobility. We're using about a 50-year-old aircraft to get it done. We do air refueling. We lift cargo and personnel, and we provide air medical evac. If you've noticed, there was a billboard on Route 1 South there for a while talking about next generation tanker, the Boeing product. That was the one that got selected. We are in contention to get the plane based at our local base. There's some discussion about how that would really affect our mission. Well, it's the exact same mission with just newer aircraft. It would be air refueling and global mobility, hauling people and cargo, aeromedical evac, and that is what we do. So it would be really no change in mission, just newer aircraft. And I know you fine folks are all busy, so I am going to dismiss myself unless you guys have any questions.
Thank you very much, and we appreciate the Air Guards being an integral part of our community, and we appreciate your informing us about the upgrade in your what it is you have. Councilors, there is under presentations what is typically a resolution, but in this case it's closer in the agenda for purposes of convenience. Chair would entertain a motion to suspend the rules for the purpose
so moved.
Of...
Thank you very much.
Okay. And we thank you, Bill. You can have a seat. And we do have a resolution before us. I'd be happy to read the resolution and then...
But we have to vote on the suspension of the
rules. I'm sorry. We do. Thank you, Councilor Smith. all in favor of suspending the rules?
Aye.
Any opposed? None opposed. Now, we've suspended the rules, and Chair will entertain a motion as regards the resolution.
Move to adopt the resolution as presented.
Second.
Thank you, Councilor Smith. Thank you, Councilor Lister. I'll read it. I'll read that resolution so that you have it read here into the record. Whereas a resolution for support of the basing of the KCX at Pease ANGB. Whereas the Mayor and Council of Portsmouth recognize the current and longstanding support of the U.S. military and the local bases by the residents of the City of Portsmouth. Whereas there is specific support of the ongoing global mobility mission of the 157th Air Refueling Wing at Pease National Air Guard Base, whereas the Mayor and Council of Portsmouth further recognize the continuing positive impacts of the integration of an Air National Guard unit into our community, now therefore be it resolved, the Mayor and the City Council of the City of Portsmouth, City of Rockingham, State of New Hampshire, and United States of America hereby support and endorse the basing of the mobility aircraft at Pease ANGB. Be it further resolved, the elected leadership of this community strongly support and encourage the basing of the new tanker aircraft, the KC-46A, at Pease ANGB. This resolution shall take effect on passage. Having read the resolution, does anyone care to discuss it or comment? Hearing no one seek to speak, we'll ask for a vote. All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
None opposed? It passes unanimously, and thank you very much for coming in and informing us.
Thank you.
Thank you. We have under item two the Mayor's Awards for the PHS, World Champion PHS Percussion Ensemble. Due to other commitments and other school activities, they will not be able to begin until 8 o'clock. So we'll proceed with the meeting, but at that time I would ask that we suspend the rules and proceed with their presentation. Moving forward, we have minutes before you. Item five, the minutes of May 2nd, 2011 and May 9th, 2011. And I would entertain a motion as to both or either, depending upon the maker of the motion.
I'd like to make a motion for approval of both sets of minutes.
Thank you, Assistant Mayor Noveling-Clayburgh. We have a second discussion. Hearing none, all in favor?
Aye.
None opposed, it's unanimous. We now move on to the public comment portion of the agenda. As you know, you have 3 minutes to speak in public comment about the subject of your choice. At 2 minutes and 30 seconds, the city attorney will raise a sign that indicates you have 30 seconds remaining, and then after that, when you see the red thank you sign hoisted, you will know that your time is up. There are three speakers this evening. I'd ask you to come forward and identify yourself and speak for the 3 minutes on the subject you choose. And I typically will tonight read your name and typically the topic. So our first speaker this evening is Jennifer LaBarge regarding the firefighter station budget. Welcome.
Thank you. My name is Jennifer LaBarge Seabrook. I'm a resident of Portsmouth. I have been so since 1984. Recently, most of us attended a memorial service at the South Street Cemetery. It is an event that I choose not to miss every year. The keynote speaker this year reminded us that in the past, battles were won by the soldiers, but it was the people that won the war. At the end of his speech, he suggested that as we go each year to celebrate memorials, that we, instead of spending money at the mall or buying a new mattress, that we might consider donating our money to a local veterans organization. I sat there thinking about the various battles that have been won on our behalf and some of the photographs that were made famous of that. Obviously, the one with Iwo Jima. The soldiers raised the American flag on the behalf of the American citizens. Then I started thinking about 9/11 and who rose the flag on that day. It was the firefighters. They were called to battle that day on our behalf. Every time a 911 call is made, that is a call to battle. I personally have experienced what that is like. One of the battles that my family had was in 1963, when the EMT people came and rescued my mother. In 1970, we had a fire. It was going to destroy our home. But the firefighters came and they fought the barn fire. They saved our pets. They saved my family. Another battle my family has experienced, 1976. My father fell off the roof. The bucket of paint was landed on his face. He was drowning in paint. EMT folks were there within 1 minute. My daughter lives because of the battle that occurred in 2002. The Hampton Falls Fire Station was the only building in town that had a generator, and my daughter needed to have a special treatment so that she could breathe. I personally experienced a battle in 2005 when I was in a car accident. I don't know who the gentleman was. He was an EMT person, but the man held my hand and gave me oxygen because I was afraid. What I can say is this. The soldiers that fought on our behalf did so because they believed in our life, our liberty, and pursuit of happiness as American citizens. What is the difference with the firemen? Now, if we close down the station and if we cut back on staff, it could very well mean the life of someone that you know, that you care about. I would ask, as we consider the budget, that we allocate the funds so that no life is spared. Thank you.
Thank you. Our next speaker is, and you're going to have to apologize, I'm going to have to apologize because I'm having a hard time seeing the name, but I think it's Reillard Solluet, perhaps. Does that, someone put their name on there. They're from 100 Lafayette Road in Portsmouth. Anybody? It's R-E-R-I-E-L-D-U-D-S-O-L-I-C or U-E-T-T-E. Does that ring any bells with anybody? Okay. Well, I get to our third and final speaker, and if Mr. Solluet shows up, or he or she, we certainly would welcome him to speak. Paul Mantle regarding Station 3 in the budget.
Good evening, Mr. Mayor, City Manager, City Councilors. I'm asking you to fund the PFD and keep Station 3 open. The PFD, the Portsmouth Fire Department, has submitted a flat budget for the past three fiscal years. Your response to their sound fiscal management was to cut them $100K last year. The Portsmouth Fire Department generates well over $500,000 annually to the city, but gets no credit for this revenue. There's no need to raise taxes to fund them. Use the ambulance revenue or any of the excess funds from the past four fiscal years. That's about $12 million. Or last year's unused collective bargaining contingency fund. That's nearly 800 grand. This budget process has been quite interesting and illuminating. I'm wondering whether the current push for a zero budget is some sort of election year machination. Where was this push in 2009 or 2010, where times were really tough? No matter. Some observations. I've heard a councilor ask the fire chief whether the council should increase the tax rate by 5.1%. That's over $3.4 million. I believe the fire department is only looking for about $360,000. I guess that's another open mouth insert foot moment. For the councillor chastise and criticize the fire chief for personnel costs in his department, when the chief has no say in this matter. Rather ironic when you consider that the same councillor moved and or approved every contract the fire department is currently operating under. I wonder where that depth of analytical thought was when the councillor voted to approve those contracts. I've heard a councillor describe another councillor's valiant effort to fund the fire department and keep Station 3 open as an accounting trick. It's very interesting. Is it an accounting trick to label some unnamed Muni employee's salary and benefits totaling over $145,000 anticipated expenses? Or, as I mentioned before, the $12 million in excess revenue over expenditures from the past four fiscal years magically disappeared? No, I guess not. An accounting trick is when you disagree with that. When you agree with it, such as the $1.8 million for the second gym, then it's a creative solution. Keep Station 3 open. It would be befitting the city of Portsmouth. Thank you.
Thank you. That concludes the public comment session for this evening, and we now move on to the public hearing, which is for the resolution authorizing borrowing in anticipation of revenue and taxes not to exceed $16 million. If someone well, we're going to have a public hearing and it will be voted on at a later point in the agenda. So at this time, I'll explain the rules for the public hearing. Unlike a public comment session, in a public hearing, you may speak as long as you wish on the matter at hand. I would ask that you all try to queue up and speak in order and move along in a timely fashion so that we can be considerate of your neighbors and everyone else who is speaking this evening, if there are people speaking to this. And once that speaking has ended, I will close the public hearing, and again, action will be taken on this matter on another portion of the agenda. So with that, I am...
Your Honor, it might be useful for me to just explain what it is.
Please go ahead.
Okay, the borrowing in anticipation of revenues, basically, under state law, the city bills for property taxes twice a year in arrears. For example, the first half tax bill in fiscal 12 will be issued in October and is not due till December 1st, 2011, even though our fiscal year starts on July 1, 2011. Similarly, the second half bill is not due to June 1, 2012. Because property taxes constitute our single largest source of revenue, this lag in billing may cause a temporary cash flow problem for us in both the beginning and middle of the fiscal year. If necessary, and I say if necessary, we would then be allowed to borrow money on a short-term basis until the property taxes come in. So if we ever had to exercise this option, it would be only for a matter of months. So the money would be a short-term option. The resolution requires a public hearing that we'll be having and then a two-thirds vote of the City Council. But again, we do this every year just in case we need to borrow for cash flow purposes.
Thank you for that explanation. So with that, I will proceed with opening the public hearing. Please come up and speak and state your name and address and speak for this on the record. I now open the public hearing. Does anyone care to speak in? Rise and speak. Seeing no one rise, I close the public hearing. And we move on to approval of grants and donations. The first is item A, acceptance of a police department grants as follows. First is a New Hampshire Department Highway of Safety for a series of three sobriety checkpoints, $9,900. New Hampshire Department of Highway Safety for DWI DUI patrols, $6,050. New Hampshire Department of Highway Safety for DWI Hunter patrols, $2,475. New Hampshire Department of Highway Safety for red light running enforcement, $6,050. New Hampshire Department of Highway Safety for pedestrian patrols, $650. And New Hampshire Department of Highway Safety for speed enforcement patrols, $650. Do we have a motion to approve and accept?
So moved.
Second.
We have a motion. We have a second. Discussion. Hearing none, all in favor?
Aye.
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 None opposed? That's unanimous. Item C, which is...
No,
sorry, I skipped item B.
Second.
acceptance of donations to the Police Explorer Cadet Post and Academy as follows. Mr. and Mrs. O. Taggart for $250, and Mr. J. Page for $200. Do we have a motion?
So moved.
Thank you, Counselor Kennedy. Thank you for the second. Discussion. Hearing none, all in favor?
Aye.
None opposed, it's unanimous. Item C, acceptance of donation for the African Burying Ground fundraising costs. It's been a donation of $114.95 from Jane James for fundraising soft costs associated with the African Burying Ground Memorial Park. Do we have a motion?
So moved.
Second.
We have a motion to accept. Discussion. Seconded. Do we have discussion? Hearing none, all in favor?
Aye.
None opposed? That's unanimous. We now move to the resolution for the adoption of the budget. And so I'll state out front, we're really talking about two portions of this. The first would be the departments and non-operating, and then there would be the fee portion of this. What I would suggest is that if we get a motion on the floor to adopt it as offered, and again, that lists each department, and that once that's on the floor, if people wish to engage in amendment practice and such, we can move down the line and see. So, for example, if someone makes the motion and it gets and it's on, we'll do municipal, police, fire, and school, and go one by one. And certainly, if people again are going to engage in motion practice or other discussion, they're welcome to do so. So, at this time, the chair will entertain a motion.
Your Honor, if I
yes,
might,
John.
The resolution probably should be put on the table as the whole, which is the total that has $86,456,844. Once the motion, I would say, is on the table with that resolution, then amendments may be made. I think I just want to clarify that.
That was my intention.
Okay, very good.
So moved.
Second.
Moved, seconded. Okay, all right. So we've made a motion, we've seconded. Now the discussion begins. So if to assist everyone in moving forward, I'll just start at the top. Again, people are free to make a motion to amend at any time. The first is municipal. That's listed as $15,442,527. The second is police at $8,438,765. Third is fire at $6,722,490. Fourth is school at $36,904,000. Collective bargaining contingency is listed as $900,000. Non-operating is $18,049,152 for a grand total of $86,456,844. And there we are. So it's before us properly. Do people care to discuss?
I'd like to make one correction for the record.
Yep.
On the police was 8438675, and you said 7.
My apologies. Thank you for the correction.
I'll do it.
Councilor Dwyer?
I want to put forth a motion that actually addresses and uses some of the additional parking revenues that a couple of months ago or a couple of council meetings ago, we voted to increase parking revenues, and we received the estimate of that, which would be approximately $400,000 in total. Now that I realize that's the total amount, just from the information we have about the first Sunday enforcement, we're clearly well on track to receiving that estimate or more from the various changes that were made. And I think it would be worthwhile to take approximately half of this estimated increase in revenue and look at two issues in public safety. And both are related to...
Let me just ask, before you go on in advocating,
so
you should get
amend.
A succinct motion to amend.
Okay.
Yeah.
So I will vote to amend the bottom line by $200,000, which is half of that projected increase. And I can talk about how I would distribute
that. Well, I think, let's again, in case people ask to have the motion read back, we want to try to keep it. So it's
$200,000
split in what way?
Split in with $50,000 added to the police budget, $150,000 to the fire budget. And I can talk more to.
Second.
Okay, we got a motion on the floor. We've got a second. Councilor Dwyer.
Okay. I think the, and I will say, I know in both of these cases, this is not enough money this is not what either of those departments would want to do, what I'm going to suggest they should do with it. In the case of police, it's the downtown patrol. I think if we've heard from anything from downtown commercial interests, they do want that downtown beat officer. We are putting the burden on them with the increased parking revenue. I think that's a fair trade. If we've heard from anything about people who are covered by Station 3, it's they want to continue services in that area with some retirements, with changes that might be made otherwise in the way that the fire department is staffed. That $150,000 would go a long way toward maintaining services there. I do not know if over the long run we'll be able to maintain Station 3, but I don't think we're ready yet to say, I don't think we've made an appropriate transition to be able to say we're not maintaining services from Station 3. And so those are sort of my two reasons for those two. It would mean both departments would need to make some changes, find other ways to do both of those functions. I also realize that we don't have item line authority, so that there's no guarantee that they would carry out those functions if we added those dollars.
Thank you, Councilor Dwyer. Discussion, Councilor Spear.
Thank you. I like the, I'm going to vote against the motion. I like the approach, especially with the downtown police officer funded through the parking meters. I actually think that's a direction we should be moving in toward, and that the meter revenue gets used to benefit the people who are paying the fee immediately. However, in this case, the 8 cents on the tax rate, which were estimated to have a reduction due to the meter fee, I think that money is going already spent, and in two ways. Number one, we can't forget we're already getting sewer increases. And whether it's a tax or a fee, or I think people are going to be paying more, and so they've already soaked up the 8 cent reduction. Now, I didn't check the math on that, but that's all. I know enough to know that's generally true. And the second thing is we haven't yet heard from the state in terms of the pushdown we're going to get from Concord. And I think that's going to easily swamp our 8 cent savings from the parking revenue. Now, in the event, and I'd rather not spend money than I believe that we don't have, in the event that something wild were to happen and there was no pushdown and the 8 cents reduction held fast, then I would be the first to revisit this issue later on this summer or later on this fall. And I know people don't like to do that from a budgeting standpoint, but I'm much more comfortable doing that than voting for those increases now and then finding out that the state has pushed down increased costs and now we have to go back and undo those budgets. So for that reason, I believe the prudent thing to do with the way the local economy is now, with the way all the other departments have managed their budgets, is to stick with the level funded budget from the previous year.
Thank you, Councilor Spear. Councilor Lister.
Thank you. I also will be voting against the amendment. My reasons are that we said as a council that we would come in at zero. We've had that line for a long time. People have made sacrifices. I know in the schools, the police, and the fire. And not that I personally don't want anybody to make sacrifices, but we have had to give up things in each department. We also said that in addition to working towards a zero base budget, if we were going to at some point, and this isn't about Station 3, personally I have some concerns about Station 3 being open because of the age of the building and it not being modernized, that eventually we may not be able to sustain that building. That's correct. But I think that because the building needs work, I would like to see Station 3 stay open, but I just want to also mention that, you know, we have people that think that there's an ambulance out there now, and there is not an ambulance, and probably should be because of the area that they work. But if we were to revisit a supplemental at some point, I would not be opposed to having a discussion about that. I see that different from tonight. I see tonight we're voting on the budget, which is a zero increase where we said we'd be. The council has taken criticism in the past for not being able to make up their mind and being a moving target. and I'm concerned about the credibility with that. But also, if we looked at some point down the road for supplemental for police and fire in the two items that are in question, that would give us an opportunity to work with the police chief and the fire chief to be able to come up with a plan exactly how we're going to spend that money, and maybe in 4 to 6 month increments, and not just jump ahead for all the same reasons that Councilor Spear had mentioned, including the state. So I would like to see us vote on the budget tonight, and then if there are issues around public safety that we need to work on, where that money comes from, the parking fees or whatever, I'd be glad to have that conversation.
Thank you, Councilor. Councilor Hetmanek.
I concur with everything that Councilor Spear and Councilor Lister have said, and add another point. I think I supported the supplemental to keep Fire Station 3 open a few months ago when we voted on that, in the hopes that we would find some sort of solution before the budget came down the pike. And the cost of keeping Fire Station 3 open only escalated to $360,000. So if we give them $150,000, everything I heard was that doesn't keep the fire station open. So I'm not sure what we're accomplishing. So I appreciate the effort to do that, but I think the Fire Commission clearly said they need $360,000. So I won't support the motion because I don't know what it accomplishes.
Councilor Smith will come back up this way.
Thank you. I'll be supporting the motion, and personally, I'd be even happier to raise it higher. I think Station 3 is very important. Not only has the police chief very, very clearly has stated to us that Station 3 handles the I-95 corridor, it handles Gosling Meadows, P's of 7,000 employees, of which some of those companies are there 24 hours a day. It's going to have a new rehab hospital on Pease. It handles the Oriental Heights neighborhood, and let alone all of Panaway Manor. To think that we would want to add even 1 minute of response time to an EMT to get to somebody, I think is cutting the public short of the services that they ask us to give. It is true there's not an ambulance out at Pease, but the chief has made it extremely clear to us that an ambulance is nothing more than a transportation vehicle. The fire engine that's there has all the equipment on there and can help save a life, protect somebody until transportation gets there. Normally, when we're in the process and whenever we've done budgets in the past sitting up here, we've been allowed to have these discussions at a work session. That did not happen last one. Everyone wanted to wait till we got here. So now here we are, and still no one wants to have the discussion. We'll put it off manana. We'll do it as a supplemental later time. I'm sorry. I'm not willing to put anyone's life at risk, and I'm strongly encouraging the members of this council to support and keep Station 3 open. As for the police department, keeping a downtown beat officer is important. That's where the economic engine of this city lives. That's where our restaurants, our small businesses, our residents, that's the biggest congested area. And for people to say, oh, we have enough police officers, there are 5 zones in the city, and we put an officer in each one. And you start looking at where those calls come from, Crossroads House, Gosling Meadows, and other areas, the bars downtown. You're putting public safety in jeopardy. And it's not just, you know, a little bit of graffiti or something like that. In the newspapers, talk to the police officers. Hear the work that they're doing on a day-to-day basis, keeping the drugs out, the sex offenders out. And to think that we would put public safety in jeopardy, again, is being very short-sighted from this council. I will be supporting the motion.
Thank you, Councilor Smith. Councilor Dwyer.
Unless there are
well, there are other first time. Yeah, Councilor Coviello. And then Councilor Kennedy.
Sure. Is it inappropriate at this time to ask the chief what they would do with $150,000 or the fire commission? Because it didn't seem, I mean, previously the answer I thought we got was they wouldn't keep the station open with that. Have things changed? can we suspend the rules and ask? Do we need to suspend the rules, or?
Suspend the rules.
I don't think we need to suspend. We can ask them to come up.
Could someone from the chief or the fire commission?
Chief?
Good evening. Counselor, what was the question?
Are you going to keep station open, station three open with $150,000, either for a short period of time, or?
We will, certainly $150,000 will help. We will keep the station open and provide the same level of services we can for as long as we can. Keep in mind that with a $360,000 issue, fully staffed fire department, if we short man on fire prevention, it becomes a 285 problem. So $150,000 will help. We'll provide the best services that we can, but certainly I can't give you any time estimates of how long Station 3 will be open, or should we have more emergency calls in the city or more natural disasters, that money will get chewed up pretty quick. Hope that answers your question.
It does. Thank you.
Thank you. Further discussion?
If I may continue.
Sure. Or further questions, whatever you want.
I don't have any further. Is anybody else? I don't
know. No. Go ahead. We can call them back if need be. Okay. Thank you, Chief.
I don't see it solving the problem. It seems like we're just, as Councilor Smith said, just putting it off for another appropriation later on. And I doubt that next year's necessary appropriation is the same amount of money. It's probably $600,000, and the year after that, $900,000. So we're not solving the problem of the issue at hand. And nor do I think that funding it is going to make it better for a lot of those same people that we complained about, we're concerned about their well-being. We're going to be taxing them out of their home, and so it's this quandary of what we do. And I'm not willing, until we find a long-term solution, to just fund it piecemeal, month by month or quarter by quarter. We need to solve the problem, and just funding it in the short term isn't doing it. So I won't support the motion.
Councilor Kennedy.
Actually, Councilor Coviello was asking the question. Was going to ask about the chief. I'm Toyo's proposal. I see the need, and we've heard the need, but I also know the sewer rate is going up substantially, and so individuals are going to have a substantial, and I know Councilor Spears wasn't sure what to call it, but it's a tax. They're going to have a substantial tax increase. I also think that there's so many uncertainties out there. We know there's some extra funds in the budget. We've been told there's some extra funds in the budget. There were a lot of questions that were asked by a lot of different organizations that really haven't been answered yet. So I would encourage us to do what we said for once, pass the 0%. And I think as a council, we need to have more discussions on the financial stability of our city. I think we need to get all the questions that I asked and from all the information and all the questions people had in the community answered. So I don't think, like years past, we can start in January or February to really look at the budget. I think for this year, given some of the information that's just come out from the federal government, we need to make it a continuum. We need to take the people's questions, we need to answer them, we need to get answers this summer. We need to look at Station 3. I'm not sure tonight's the night to do it, but we need to really have a discussion on Station 3. We need to have a discussion on what it means to the P's companies out there. Part of that discussion might even be, what is their tax benefits from being a company out at P's? We all know they don't pay school tax for some of those companies. I mean, there's some things out there that we need to make some decisions on, and we need to get some points from those companies. I asked the chief, as one of my questions, what is it going to cost those companies if to their insurance by not having Station 3 out there? We don't know that answer yet. So I think for the community, we need to say zero tonight, but we need to make a promise as a council to keep evaluating this budget. And as the chief gets close, we need to hear from him and the firefighters on what that means. And it might be August, it might be November, it might be December, who knows when, because you don't know what your overtime is going to be. We don't know if there's going to be a major, God forbid, a major catastrophe. We don't know those things, but we're going to have to hear from you folks. We're going to have to hear from the police department. We're going to have to hear what's going on. We're going to have to know what's happening with our resources. on a monthly basis. It's not just a printout. It's hearing discussion. I mean, we're in a time that we cannot wait a year to come up with these decisions and have 2 months to make it. We need longer time. But the one thing we did promise our constituents is a 0% today. And that's what I'm going to vote for.
Councilor Dwyer.
I think it's really bad public policy to govern by supplemental appropriations because it costs a lot in the long run. So I think we need to, I understand what Councilor Coviello is saying. We haven't solved the problem yet. And I'd be the first to say we haven't solved the problem. But I don't think we'll solve the problem by saying that by the 0% that basically the fire department would fairly quickly say they can't do services from Station 3, and then we might pick it up again later. I mean, the kind of up and downness in public policy is really costly, especially when you're, you know, in some cases perhaps hiring staff, training staff, then letting staff go, re-recruiting, hiring staff, figuring out what you're going to do next. The management costs of that are kind of insupportable for what I'll call was kind of a fake promise to begin with. We didn't know what 0% would mean and all these other. Yes, we asked everybody to look at 0%, and all the departments are really good about that. But, you know, if we knew that it was a life safety issue, but we said 0% 6 months ago, so we have to keep with that promise, or we'd be accused of being wishy-washy. Well, you know, I certainly hope the people elected me wouldn't expect me to kind of go over the cliff on 0% just because I said 0% 6 months ago. So I really want to make sure that we're not going to be governing by supplemental appropriations, because that is the most costly thing anybody could do. That's just going to be up and down forever. Second, the economic engines of our community, there are two places. There's Pease and there's downtown. And why we would be sticking it to the people who are the economic engines with the two things they've asked for. They've asked to keep Station 3 open, and they've asked for the downtown beat cop. And it does not make any sense to me that we would listen to every complaint from any individual who comes up here who wants a little bit less off of their assessment, but we wouldn't listen to the economic engine and all the commercial interests of our community with something that actually is being paid for by an additional revenue source we've added, not from the percent that we have. Makes no sense to me. And then third, and I want to put this out on the table because I do think it's behind some of the concerns that, and I agree, I didn't like the attitude of the responses that the fire chief gave when the first time we had the work session with the fire department, when we kept trying to come up with solutions, we got nowhere. I know counselors didn't like that evening. I didn't like it either. I know a lot of people in the community didn't, but we've got to put that aside. That's an attitude thing and an argument and a personality thing. That's not about whether we cover public safety issues in a portion of our community. So I want to make sure that that's not a part of it, but that we can look for solutions for this, that we buy a little time here to look for what might be a longer-term solution. Just a few months ago, you know, the potential was there for covering that part of town with service agreement that we would look at with another community. Rather than kind of go backwards, I'd at least like to keep these things alive and keep moving forward on it.
Thank you, Councilor Dwyer. Assistant Mayor Novelin-Claiborne.
I will not be voting for the amendment. I'm voting for a 0% budget. I believe that suggestions have been made to the fire commission and the fire chief about ways that monies can be managed differently so that Station 3 can stay open. I believe there are ways that the money can be managed differently so that Station 3 can be open. I made some suggestions. Other councilors have made suggestions. I think they're fair. I think they're legitimate. I think they could work. So I guess what I'm asking is that the police, that the fire department think a little outside the box, think creatively to make the money work differently so that we can keep the fire station open. I honestly believe that when you look at that budget, that that can be done. As far as the downtown beat officer, I know I've talked to the police chief before about what communities like Hampton and York do in the summer. They hire part-time police patrols to patrol Hampton Beach and the downtown York area. I think it's possible that that's a solution. I think it has to be discussed with the union, but it's a possible solution, and it would cost a lot less to the department than hiring, than using full-time police officers. I know we heard Rick Condon, the president of the Firefighters Union, talk about options that could be made regarding health insurance to the union. We know that we could save money if we come up with a different health idea, a health plan for the firefighters, police officers, for everyone. I know Rick mentioned that. I think it was our work session. I think there are definite ways that the money can be managed differently so that we can come in at a 0% budget. That's what we said we were going to do. That's what we asked departments to do. And I think the council should adhere to that request that was made a few months back. I think that's all I have.
Councilor Smith.
Thank you. With this motion, it is not increasing taxes. Taxes are still at the zero increase that we all talked about. The monies is going to will come from already within the budget. So to say that, well, I don't want to vote on this because I want to vote for a zero budget, you're still voting for a zero budget because you've already raised another tax. That vote was already taken and gone. The horse is out of the barn on that one. This is a way of using the money. The money was coming from the parking revenues. To say that you don't want to do this because you're worried about stuff that's going to come down from Concord, well, we have $900,000 that we've already moved into the undesignated fund balance to start to put that aside, ready for what's going to come out of Concord. We know what's going to happen. We have money there. We want to keep around 10% in undesignated fund balance. Right now, we're over $9 million in that fund. And 10% in the budget we're looking at here is an $86 million budget. So there's still room in our savings account. To say you want to figure out what the long-term solution is, we're having an economic downturn. So building is not happening. New construction projects are down, but they are approved. And when things turn around and banks start loaning again, those projects will be built, which means an increase in revenues. We're down on the revenue side because no one's buying new cars. Well, eventually we're gonna all have to start getting new vehicles or new used vehicles because, hey, we live in the Northeast. Cars can only go so long. But this is not a tax increase. What it is doing the service, providing the services that the citizens have been asking for and they want and they're used to. And it's public safety. That's the reason why people come to this community, because it's a safe and wonderful place to live. And as for, let's have another meeting for, because I want to hear from the chief on what he thinks of it. We've already had meetings. I've heard them. And they've said, please do this. The citizens have been calling and say, please do this. The citizens all showed up and said, please don't tax us on Sunday and parking downtown. And this council ignored them. We cannot ignore them again.
Thank you, Councilor Smith. Further discussion on speaking to the amendment offered by Councilor Dwyer.
Can we call the vote?
I'm going to pass the gavel this time.
Mayor Farini.
Yes, I'm actually pleased that Councilor Dwyer offered the amendment, and though I do not intend to support it, I think that it is what we're going to see, and indeed it is sometimes not appropriate or good to engage in supplemental practice when you're trying to run your government. On the other hand, my belief is that significant work has been done in every department, and people have been, frankly, laid off over the last 3 or 4 years, such that we've reduced our force considerably in all departments here in the city of Portsmouth. It's a fact of life that the public sector expense is on a collision course with the community's ability to pay. I do believe that additional dialogue will need to happen, and maybe it will be within the confines of a supplemental discussion. I don't want to see Station 3 closed either, but I think we need to engage in a discussion as opposed to dueling advocacy. And I think that the community needs to understand that as we go forward in time, if we want to maintain the levels of service that we've now reduced to as a result of our practices over the last years, then the community's going to have to change how it thinks about paying for them, or perhaps we won't have those services. So this is the beginning of a discussion which will next year be a more involved one. And I think that a lot of voices were heard this time around in the budget process, and that was helpful, be it the study circles and be it the public hearing and that sort of thing. But I think we as a community are going to have to find a way to decide whether or not we want to pay for these services. This is the first big piece of it that we're going to see. So I'm not going to support it. Would I support a supplemental? It would be nice to have a two-way discussion about what the solutions to the problem might be. And I'm confident that our community is capable of having that discussion, and I would look forward to it in the future. But for now, I do not support the amendment. Further discussion? Okay, call the question. Roll call, please.
This is on the amendment only.
Correct.
Yep. Assistant Mayor Noveline Clayburgh?
No.
Councilor Lister?
No.
Councilor Hegemonic?
No.
Councilor Spear?
No.
Councilor Dwyer?
Yes.
Councilor Coviello?
No.
Councilor Kennedy?
No.
Councilor Smith?
Yes.
Mayor Farini?
No.
Fails 7-2.
Amendment fails.
Well, 2-7.
I'm sorry. Thank you, City Clerk. We now proceed with, again, Resolution 7-2011. The resolution as written now stands before you. Does anyone care to make further motion practice, or are we going to further discuss the budget as it stands? Councilor Spear, I saw you first.
I don't have a motion. I just have discussion on the main motion.
Please proceed.
When the city manager came out with the budget, he wrote in the introduction that since FY09, citywide, we've had a reduction of almost 64 positions, or 9% of the total staffing citywide. And I think there's a lot of reasons for that. Obviously, we've had pretty modest budgets over the past 3 years. And I think that's a good thing. The economy's been tough. But I want to bring to light, to remind people, that there's an agreement between the council as the employers and the employees on some of these staffing reductions. And I'll give two examples. I'm sure councilors can think of others. Last year, the school board proffered that the teachers could take a slightly less of an increase to give up their COLAs for 1 year. The teachers elected not to do that, so we have fewer teachers. More recently, we voted on a ranking officer's contract for the police. Now, I voted against that, but it passed. And again, it was clear that we would have higher paid ranking officers, but fewer of them. So here we are. And I think this, it kind of actually building on what the mayor had previously said, I don't think that the FY12 is the end of the discussion in terms of this dialogue. This is going to be happening for the next 4, 5, 6 years as we unwind from our previous kind of leveraged positions. And so the conversation is going to continue, and that's fine, and we'll work through these problems going in the future. But I just wanted to put out there that there's been this is part of a two-way agreement among all the adults in the community.
Thank you, Councilor Spear. Further discussion?
Do we have a motion?
We have a motion before us, the motion to adopt the budget as read. Further discussion, Councilor Coviello.
I think some comment is warranted on the state and where they're at. And I sat in this room a few weeks ago to listen to Senators Stiles and Bradley talk about their proposed plan for the I think it's Senate Bill 3 on the retirement reform. And we seem to have I don't think collectively as a city or as a state we have an understanding of the problem we have ahead of us. And this budget assumes that we have a state's portion is going to be 35%. No one's talking 35%. They're talking about, even in the best of worlds, they're talking about between 22 and 25% covering. So we know some pain is coming in that. And these budget and these pension reforms that the senators were talking about, we're only going to eliminate about 20% of the problem, of the unfunded portion of the pension liability. We're only 20% in the outrage we hear from both sides. Over 20% solution to a problem tells me that we are just not thinking in real terms on this budget, on the state budget, and I know we're trying our best here locally. We can only do what we're told is coming from Concord, and I appreciate what the city manager's done. I'm not suggesting that he should have done something differently, but that 8 cents that's predicted as a savings is gone. This the idea that we're going to have a 0% tax increase is a fallacy. I mean, there's money. There's a lot of money that needs to be spent on promises made by our parents, that and promises that can't be kept. Frankly, we just can't afford to keep them. And so we need to wake up and realize that we're not going to have a 0% budget, even though we may pass one with an eight cent decrease. There is money that needs to be spent on these promises.
Councilor Smith.
Thank you. If it does come down that it's going to be 20 or 25% that comes out of Concord, that's the reason why we're moving into our collective bargaining contingency of $900,000, which is laid out in our resolution tonight. That money is going to be, will be able to be used towards whatever's going to come down from Concord. We've had this discussion. We've had it back there. We've had it out here. We know we're going to have some expenses that are coming down. We're working with Concord and trying to minimize those. Realizing how difficult it is out there, this is, while it's a good budget, it's really, the taxpayers out there don't think they realize what services are going to be lost, how it's going to be completely different out from coming out of this budget. But next year's budget is probably going to be tougher, but hopefully, if we have some of these building projects that come along, it will be easier. When you have the Portwalk project, you know, they have a new building that's going up. That will be in our tax base next year. On Islington Street, there's a brand new building going up. That will be in the tax base next year. There's another building on Maplewood Avenue that's about to go under construction with completely redoing it. That's going to be in the tax base next year. And the idea of, you know, to try to save money to by having part-time cops, I'm sorry, we're not a part-time city. You know, we start from Labor Day right to the first of the year. And even in the winter, the bars are still going. There are still things happening. I think we're being short-sighted on some of this.
Thank you, Councilor Smith. Further discussion? If not, I'll move past the gavel.
Mayor Farini.
Thank you. I just want to say, and I'm sure councilors agree, that the patience and hard work that everyone is engaged in to get to this point. I do think I want to be very clear, though, to the citizens of Portsmouth, as you've heard tonight's discussion and the differing points of view on where we go from here, that that is indeed the discussion that we need to have as a community. And it is easy to point the finger backward and say, aha, we did it. We did a 0% increase. That's the wrong answer. The reason is we were able to do it, and it took a lot of hard work, and people really, you know, did a great job. But at this point, the citizens of Portsmouth are really presented with a dilemma next year as to what their services really are going to be. And it's a very real problem, and the fire station issue illuminates that. I think that we need to take the same hopeful, engaged view that we have as a community typically for these kinds of things. We all need to continue to work together and figure out how we're going to do it. I do think it helps when, you know, spectrums of suggestions are discussed in an open forum with the professionals who need to provide the service and the council who needs to figure out how they're going to be paid for by the community. I'm optimistic that will happen in the future, and I certainly hope and believe that it's in the community's best interest to do that. So while it is not an easy thing, and again, the discussions tonight have been illuminating, I do believe that our community going forward has really an opportunity to try to continue to match this cost of the public sector with private sector's ability to pay, and Portsmouth will make the right decision ultimately, I believe. This time I support the budget as it stands.
Counselor Dwyer.
Normally, I would allow the mayor to have the last word, but I mean, this is just like 10 minutes of like being all over the place, and I have heard everybody who's spoken in a way say we need to talk about the balance between services and budget. And I think Councilor Smith made an attempt to do that at the work session that we had. It didn't go anywhere. That wasn't probably the night for people to do that. But we really do have to do that. And I think the Portsmouth Listen Circles attempted to do that. And so I want to make sure we figure out a way to do that, because I do think that what most people in the community, maybe they have a stray complaint here or there, but largely they have seemed to think this year that we're on the right track, and that what I don't hear people saying is, boy, it's 2 cents or it's 3 cents or it's 8 cents. What I hear people talking about is what they like about the schools, that they have the parks, that we have recreation, that the town is clean, that snow is picked up, that on and on and on. And I don't think we have enough talk about what we're getting for our money. Rather, we're talking over, did I say 2 cents or did I say 1 cent? And that is a kind of a meaningless, abstract discussion. I think the discussion that we do need to try to have is, as we did last year, okay, we can live without public support of a pool. I mean, I think last year's discussion really got us to some creative solutions, because we were actually talking about services, not, you know, I made a promise for 0%, and as Councilor Cobiello said, you know, that's a false promise anyway, because it's only a little moment in time until we figure out what happens with the state. So I would hope that we can have that discussion soon, and that it be a services discussion, because that's what the role of the city is. It's to provide service. It's all about services and infrastructure. That's what we do. That's what city government does. We don't dicker between, you know, the lines in an Excel spreadsheet looking for the last 2 cents. I really think if we're going to be taking our job seriously, then it has to be we can do without X or we can't do without Y. And I am disappointed, as Councillor Smith said, that that discussion has not happened around this budget, and that we've been so focused on the fakeness of an artificial number as opposed to really talking about services. And so I would say that we should not let a council meeting go by without putting some topic on the table to discuss as services, and let the community come out and say, we need it, we don't like it, we want more of it. Because I have not heard people having the service discussion.
Thank you, Councilor Dwyer. Further discussion? Hearing none, we'll call the question. Roll call vote, please.
Assistant Mayor Noveline Clayburgh?
Yes.
Councilor Lister?
Yes.
Councilor Hegemonic?
Yes.
Councilor Spear?
Yes.
Councilor Dwyer?
Yes.
Councilor Coviello?
Yes.
Councilor Kennedy?
Yes.
Councilor Smith?
Yes.
Mayor Farini?
Yes.
Unanimous. Resolution 7 passes.
At this time, we have a number of other resolutions. They are the municipal fees, sewer fund expenditures, water fund expenditures, et cetera. But we have, as a result of scheduling a presentation later in the agenda, and I would request and have indicated on your package that we're going to welcome the world champion PHS percussion ensemble to briefly perform for us and then accept some awards. So if we could welcome them in and ask them to get set up. Also like to welcome Steve Cirillo and all the parents and the chaperones who've helped, and I hope you don't find this unfair before we let you go home and do your year-end homework that you're trying to avoid. That because we have awards for you, we figure we'd ask you to play first just so we could be sure that we'd hear the music. So we appreciate it very much, and as you get set up, I'm sure we'll all be greatly entertained. And thank you for taking time out of your evenings and making the effort to come here and get this set up. And thank you, Steve Cirillo.
Say a couple of quick things. This is our piece called Festive Overture by Dmitri Shostakovich, transcribed and arranged for percussion instruments. Usually when we go to a competition, we have a good half hour warm up, and our warm up was standing outside. So we didn't get to warm up, so we apologize if it's not at world championship level, but I just want to also let you know that it's going to be loud in here. So, so enjoy. This is Festive Overture by Dmitri Shostakovich. Thank you.
Wow, that was great. We're really appreciative that you were able to do that for us this evening. Can't thank you enough. It helps us refocus our minds for the work at hand. And at this time, I would like to go forward and ask you, I'm going to ask you one by one to come up. We're going to present you with a mayor's award and a few gifts on behalf of the city in recognition of your fine accomplishment. Our first is going to be Kathleen Fitzgerald. Our next is T.J. Boynton. The next is Teresa Peck. Next is Allie Stillman.
Because of the upper body stuff. That's funny, isn't it? Congratulations, Allie.
Max Boynton. Bobby George.
Nice job, Bobby.
Sabina Gesse. Allie Reardon. Joey Warren.
Great job, Joey.
Ryan Dio.
Great job, Ryan. Good job.
Jess Kowalski. Madsen Losowe McComsey. Kelsey Zukowski. Seth Lampert. I don't think he's even in high school yet.
Great job, Seth. Nice job.
Emma Booth.
Good job, Emma.
Matthew Vogt. Carolyn Hebert. Sean Egan. Maria Tulois Kozak. Kristen Fuller.
Great job.
Chris Richards.
Haley Smith.
I'm going to have to. All right. All right, you can get that to Haley. And Nick Floros?
Nope.
Nick? Nick Floros.
Good job, man.
Adrian Snyder.
Cassie Zukowski. Kaylee Zukowski.
Great job.
Vivian Burnell. I'd like to welcome the director, Steve Cirillo.
Congratulations.
Steve, we're going to ask you to say a few words, but before we do, we have a number of gifts here also for the chaperones, and I just want to make sure that I read their names, but in the interest of time, meaning no disrespect, we won't have you come up. Dave and Lori Lampert, Bob and Doreen George, Dee Dee Stillman, Mark Vogt, Jared Iverson, Rick Mason, and Matt Toby. Thanks for your hard work. Please.
This is on.
It
is. Evening. Thank you for everything you do for us. You know, our administration's here, our superintendent, our assistant superintendent, city council. Portsmouth is a great place to live because of everything that we have. And this is just an example of what makes Portsmouth great. If you were around on Memorial Day or Veterans Day or any of those days or at the groundbreaking ceremony at the middle school today, it is a great city. Thank you for keeping it a great city. Honored to work in Portsmouth for 23 years, so thank you very much. This group of wonderful students had a lot to overcome this year, and I can tell you it wasn't easy, but when the cards are down and everything's down, you dig down deep, and as I've always told them, if you work hard and do your best, anything is possible. And if you believe anything is possible, world championships are possible, and you can ask them. We were just happy to go to the world championships this year. But the attitude was right, and when you have the right attitude, and that's a great lesson for anyone in life, you can accomplish anything. So I couldn't be prouder than any other group. I've been here 23 years, and they've just showed what Portsmouth means and what it's all about to strive for excellence. So thank you for your support. Thank you to these wonderful kids, and especially those adults who made my life so wonderful this year. I couldn't do it without them there. So it's a community process, just like everything's about community. Well, the parents, the family, the city council, the school board, and the students, because we'd be nowhere for me without those students. So thank you very much for your support.
Thank you, and congratulations, world champions.
We're going to take 30 seconds and move the equipment out in the hall. We can do it that fast, okay?
Okay, fine.
Thank you very much.
We'll take a 5-minute recess, please.
This will be a soft start to let everyone get situated.
So we'll get win the Run the World Champion.
Do we have any technical difficulties over here?
No.
Okay.
Give him a
all right.
I can live with
if everyone is settled,
sitting on the floor.
We can continue. And we now have the next of those. Quite all right, Mr. Mayor. Second of the resolutions is number 8-2011. That is the resolution with the voluminous schedule, or Exhibit A, with respect to municipal fees. Do we have a motion as regards 8-2011?
So moved to accept.
Motion to adopt?
Accept the resolution, yes.
Okay, second. We have a motion. We have a second. Discussion on fees.
I have.
Assistant Mayor.
I just wanted to say, as the chairman of the fee committee, we did increase fees in various areas, as you can see. Among the departments were city clerk department, planning department, inspection department, recreation, health department, and water and sewer. So we did increase fees maybe in about, I don't know, 20 different areas. So I just thought I'd make that brief report.
Thank you, Assistant Mayor.
That's good.
Further discussion on this item? Hearing none, ready to vote? Okay, roll call, please.
Assistant Mayor Noveline Clayburgh?
Yes.
Councilor Lister?
Yes.
Councilor Hetchmanek?
Yes.
Councilor Spear?
Yes.
Councilor Dwyer?
Yes.
Councilor Coviello?
Yes.
Councilor Kennedy?
Yes.
Councilor Smith?
No.
Mayor Farini?
Yes.
8-1 passes.
We now move on to the sewer fund expenditures 9-2011 in your book and before you, and this is the resolution for making appropriation of sums of money for the necessary sewer fund expenses for operating the system this coming year. Do we have a motion?
So moved to accept resolution.
Motion to adopt. Do we have a second?
Second.
Second discussion. Councilor Kennedy.
Kind of in conjunction with the water and sewer, and I know we're just talking about sewer, but I'm gonna have to put it together. I still am looking for a rate for those people that want to be conservation minded that's lower than the current rate for the minimum amount. In other words, I know it's so much for per unit, but to lower the units to give people a benefit if they use lower units. I'm just throwing that out.
Thank you, Councilor Kennedy. Further discussion? Hearing none, roll call, ready to vote? Okay, all in favor, roll call, please.
Assistant Mayor Noveline Clayburgh?
Yes.
Councilor Lister?
Yes.
Councilor Hetchmanek?
Yes.
Councilor Spear?
Yes.
Councilor Dwyer?
Yes.
Councilor Coviello?
Yes.
Councilor Kennedy?
Yes.
Councilor Smith?
No.
Mayor Farini?
Yes.
Passes 8-1.
Next is the water fund expenditures. That is item 10-2011. And the resolution is before you for the appropriation of sums of money for necessary water fund expenses for the operation of the water system of the city for the upcoming fiscal year. Do we have a motion to adopt?
So moved. Second.
We have a motion. We have a second discussion. Councilor Kennedy.
Like the sewer, and I'm really encouraging this for the water. I think we have to encourage people to use less water. And for those of us that are using less water, I still think we can lower it down the units and do a better price per unit for those people that might use one or two. The other thing is my guess is, and it's not been validated by any research, but my guess is that some of our elderly population uses less water than some of our families and other populations. And it might be a way to support them. So I think we should give credit if people can conserve water in our community. I don't think we do enough of that for conservation. And I would really, for I think this is probably the third or fourth year I've asked for this, I really am going to push it this next year to look at it. So I'm forewarning now, but I think we need to figure out a way to give people. We are adding a huge expense with the sewer and water. There is no doubt about that. And it's a huge tax that we're adding. And I think that we really need to look at people that can serve and give them credit for it.
Thank you, Councilor Kennedy. Councilor Lister.
I'd just like to, could I just please acknowledge the
Public Works Department for the efforts they put through for the city and really trying to encourage people to use rain barrels and the faucet, special faucet kits that they have, and among other things. So they're really working to educate the community, and that goes along with what Councilor Kennedy is saying. It's going to take an education for everyone to really conserve water. But thank you to the Public Works Department.
Thank you, Councilor Lister. Further discussion? Hearing none, ready to vote. Roll call, please. Councilor Smith, did I see you venture forth? I'm sorry.
Just move my mic.
Okay.
Assistant Mayor Noveleen Clayburgh.
Yes.
Councilor Lister.
Yes.
Councilor Hetchmanik.
Yes.
Councilor Spear.
Yes.
Councilor Dwyer.
Yes.
Councilor Coviello.
Yes.
Councilor Kennedy.
Yes.
Councilor Smith.
No.
Mayor Farini.
Yes.
8-1 passes.
Our next resolution before us is Resolution 11-2011, Special Revenues for Necessary Expenditures and Designated Fund Balances for the fiscal year ending June 30, 2012. Do we have a motion to adopt?
So moved.
Thank you, Assistant Mayor. Do we have a second? We have a second. Discussion. Seeing no one venture forth, ready to vote? All in favor, roll call, please.
Assistant Mayor Noveleen Clayburgh.
Yes.
Councilor Lister.
Yes.
Councilor Hegemonic.
Yes.
Councilor Spear.
Yes.
Councilor Dwyer.
Yes.
Councilor Coviello.
Yes.
Councilor Kennedy.
Yes.
Councilor Smith.
Yes.
Mayor Farini.
Yes.
That's unanimous.
We have before us the last of the budget resolutions. That is the Resolution 12-2011, Resolution Approving the Investment Policy for the Fiscal Year Ending June 30, 2012, set forth before you in your package. Do we have a motion to adopt?
So moved.
Second.
Thanks, Councilor Smith. Councilor Coviello for the second. Any discussion? Hearing none, all in favor, roll call, please.
Assistant Mayor Noveleen Clayburgh.
Yes.
Councilor Lister.
Yes.
Councilor Hegemonic.
Yes.
Councilor Spear.
Yes.
Councilor Dwyer.
Yes.
Councilor Coviello.
Yes.
Councilor Kennedy.
Yes.
Councilor Smith.
Yes.
Mayor Farini.
Yes.
Unanimous. Resolution number 12 is adopted.
Thank you. Thank you, everyone. We now move on to item B, which is the adoption of resolution authorizing borrowing in anticipation of revenue and taxes not to exceed $16 million. And that resolution is now before us. Does anyone care to make a motion to adopt?
So moved.
Second.
Thank you. Does anyone care to speak to it? At this point, okay. Then all in favor?
Aye.
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 None opposed? It's unanimous. Thank you. Item C, third and final reading of the proposed ordinance amending Chapter 10, Article 4, Section 10.420, District Location and Boundaries, rezoning of land at 54 Rogers Street from Municipal M to Mixed Residence Office, and zoning map referenced in Chapter 10. A motion be to pass third and final reading on the proposed ordinance as presented.
So moved.
Thanks, Councilor Smith.
Second.
We have a second. Thank you. Discussion. Hearing none. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
None opposed? It's unanimous. We now have a consent agenda. Three items are on the consent agenda, and a motion be in order to adopt it.
I'd like to remove item C, please.
Noted for the record. We'll go forward with items A and B unless anyone else has a further request. Okay, with that, Councilor Smith, we'll go forward with A and B. First being a letter from David Hollowell, Portsmouth Maritime Folk Festival, requesting permission to hold the Maritime Folk Festival on Saturday, September 24, 2011, and Sunday, September 25, 2011. The second is a letter from Cynthia Yates Ripsick, Alzheimer's Association, requesting permission to hold the Walk to End Alzheimer's at Wentworth Connections on Saturday, September 24, 2011, at 10 o'clock a.m.
Move to pass the consent agenda.
Second.
Thank you, Councilor Smith. Second from the Assistant Mayor. Discussion. Hearing none. All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
None opposed? It's unanimous. Item C is a letter from Ariel Silanpa on behalf of the merchants on Deer Street to display Deer Street open flags during normal business hours. Do we have a motion?
So moved.
A motion to adopt.
Second.
Or a motion to refer to the city power with power technically second. Thank you, Councilor Dwyer.
I'll be abstaining from this.
Thank you, Councilor Smith. Any further discussion? Hearing none. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
None opposed? One abstention. Councilor Smith.
Thank
We now move on to item 11, which is presentation and consideration of written communications and petitions. Item A is a letter from Attorney John McGee Jr. of Flynn and McGee, PA, regarding the boundary issue in the Arthur McDonald Trust, the Portsmouth Middle School boundary.
Move to refer to the planning board for a report to us back.
Thank you.
Second.
Thank you, Councilor Dwyer. Councilor Smith, discussion. Hearing none, all in favor?
Aye.
None opposed. That is unanimous. Chair votes aye. Item C, a petition from Portsmouth residents to express displeasure with the street art and requesting future public.
Item B.
I'm sorry, I skipped B. Letter from Philip Cohen to Stephanie Kren, co-chair Ahana, regarding the emergency access from Atlantic Heights area neighborhood. You have the letter in the file. Does anyone care to make a motion?
Move to Traffic Safety Committee for a report back.
Second.
Thank you, Councilor Smith. Assistant Mayor Nobling-Claiborne, Councilor Dwyer.
I know that maybe 3 or 4 years ago this came up, and I remember the city manager, I think at that time, perhaps talking with PSNH that owned part of the land, and I thought there was a temporary resolution. So could you speak to that?
Sure, if I might,
Please
Your
do.
Honor. Yes, the PSNH does allow us, in the case of an extreme emergency, would allow us to access through that dirt road. Unfortunately, that road is very substandard for anybody that's not familiar with it, other than, you know, PSNH personnel. The only times we would use that is if we knew there was going to be a closure for a substantial amount of time. We would have to then activate people to be out on that roadway at various intervals to make sure people could safely navigate it. It's a pretty rough road out there. It's dirt road in a lot of places. There's a lot of ups and downs on it and curves, and it really is a very, very difficult road to navigate. What I'd like to do is, talk with the Traffic and Safety Committee. There's not a lot of easy solutions. We're going to have more of a formal discussion with PSNH if we really want to make that an access on an emergency that would not last more than a few hours. We'd want to take a look at that. But right now, if it was an emergency that would close it down for a day, we'd have to get a lot of staff out there to make sure people safely navigated that road. It's a tough road.
But they have allowed it if
they have allowed it.
Okay.
Any further discussion or inquiry on this one? Councilor Spear.
Without advocating a particular solution, just looking at the map and being familiar with the area, I just want to express my own opinion that it's my opinion that we should exert resources, financial resources, or whatever we need to do to come to some sort of a good solution. And so I'm sure Traffic and Safety will look at it. But don't be limited in your thinking. Think more broadly. And so that's all I'm encouraging from my standpoint.
Thank you, Councilor Spear. Further discussion? Hearing none. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye. None opposed. It's unanimous. Next is a petition from Portsmouth residents to express displeasure with the street art and requesting future public review and discussion with the Arts Council before future displays in the city. Does anyone care to make a motion with regard to the letter and petition? Councilor Caviello.
Motion to accept and place on file. If I could get a second, I'd like to comment.
Second.
You have a second. You have the floor.
Thanks. First, I wondered if we should get a report from the city attorney about the request. I imagine there's no legal ability for us to do what the letter is requesting.
I have received myself a number of the complaints.
City attorney, please proceed. Yep.
I've received myself a number of the complaints that the petition refers to. I've thought about the matter a significant amount of time. We've discussed it on a staff level in City Hall, and it is my opinion that there is nothing that the City Council could do about the artwork which is currently on buildings in the city.
If I may continue.
Councilor Caviello.
Thanks. As you all know, I'm the council rep to the Historic District Commission, and it was a fantastic conversation at the end of the last meeting about this. And two points were raised. One was that A couple of the commissioners, one in particular, went around to look at all the artwork and made sure that none of the artwork did any damage to any of the buildings. So none of the historic nature of the buildings have been compromised. In that regard, there's no problem in that regard. The second comment was from the chairwoman, Sandra Dica, and I thought she did a great job, and I'm not going to attempt to paraphrase what she said. I don't want to I recommend you watch the meeting, the end of the meeting, very last 5 minutes, and she said it great, but I'll try to take what I took from her conversation, and that is people have a right to put art on their buildings, and we're all going to individually judge the art for whether we like it or not. And I think personally, I like that we invite and have so much artistic work in the community. Some of the art that was displayed is not something that I would want on my house or in my house, but that's just personal preference. But not unlike a neighborhood where a lot of people take a lot of care of their home and their yard, to have one neighbor not do so is a certain amount of disrespect. And a lot of people are feeling disrespected by this. Now, you may say that they're wrong to feel disrespected. This is just art and it's temporary. But I think if you're going to also say that they have a right to do this art, they also have to understand that people have a right to feel disrespected. And we could move forward every year as a community and keep doing this, and that would be fine. But and I'm not suggesting we don't keep doing street art, but I am suggesting that the organization involved with this might want to consider more conversation about the rollout or some sort of thing, because you run the risk of dividing the community, and I don't think that's what we want. So that's what I took from Chairman Deacon's comments, and I think it's something that everybody should reflect upon.
Thank you.
Thank you. Councilor Cobiello, Councilor Dwyer.
I also thought Chairman Deacon's comments were really interesting. I actually took a different thing from it, but that suggests that her comments are very artful. I think the one clarification for the various people who signed the petition, because the cover letter is actually asking for a different thing than the petition that they signed, and I always like to point that out to people, because I think sometimes people's names, the petition they signed actually is quite different from the letter that goes along with it, so that's important that people know. Sort of two comments. I think folks are maybe confusing this with the publicly supported ArtSpeak, which is a whole different entity, and that's has some important things about it because of the private nature of both the buildings that display it, as well as the entity doing this. But I also think probably the most important thing in the discussion in the community is, and I think Attorney Sullivan would agree with this, is it is really good every once in a while to have our beliefs in the First Amendment tested. And that's what this does for me. And it really says, well, do we really agree with the expression of others' free expression, or do we not? And that goes for both sides of what Chairman Dica said. So I think it was, I agree, you watch it. It was a masterful discussion, and I think it's really important for us to remember that. And that's part of what public art is all about. That's why it's so closely tied to the First Amendment.
Thank you. Councilor Smith, then we'll move down this way.
Thank you. In some inquiries I made into this, I understand that there was some discussion between the city and the museum before this went out, and maybe the city manager can briefly go over some of those discussions so that at least the public knows that the city was involved in, right, in what can happen.
The request came into the city, and when it did, I turned it over to the city attorney's office, because clearly that was really the area that needed to review it and make a determination based on our ordinances and all the legal framework that surrounded it. So the city attorney did work with the representatives from the museum, and I'd let Bob speak to the conversations relative to that.
Mr. Tainter and I met with Ms. Nunu, and we went over her proposal in some detail, and we considered the entire framework of municipal regulation of every type, and considered how it might apply to her proposal. We determined that applying this painting to the side of buildings, unless it was a sign, and a sign by definition will be something painted on the building to attract attention to a business in the building, If you look at the painting on the side of the Marple Building, it's clearly not for that purpose. Unless such a painting was a sign, then there was no municipal regulation that applied. Before any of the graffiti art was applied to any of the buildings, the museum had been to the city, discussed it with municipal staff, and we'd advise them that we do not regulate the activity. And as Councilor Dwyer points out, art is protected speech. So, you know, whenever the city approaches any protected speech issues, we would want to be careful and make sure not to attempt to assert regulation where we didn't have it, and we felt we did not have it with regard to this art.
Thank you.
Councilor Lister.
Thank you. I understand this letter may be sent in the petition placed on file, but can I also request that a copy be sent to the Historic District Commission for informational purposes?
Accept that as a friendly offering as opposed to an amendment.
Please.
Okay, I see heads nodding, so we will do that. Further discussion on this issue? Hearing none, ready to vote. All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Any opposed? None opposed. Item D is a letter from Jennifer Wilhelm regarding the decision to remove, the understory from several areas on Pierce Island. Does anyone care to make a motion with regard to this letter?
Your Honor?
Yes.
Could I make a motion to refer this to the Pierce Island Committee?
For a report back.
For a report back.
Moved. Second. We have a second. Discussion. Hearing none, all in favor?
Aye.
None opposed, it's unanimous. We now move on to the city manager's, item E is a letter from Harmon, regarding the installation of a bench in memory of Suzette King Lafleur in downtown near the North Church. Do we have a motion with regard to the letter?
Move to the city manager with power.
Second.
Discussion. Hearing none. All in favor?
Aye.
None opposed? It's unanimous. We now move to item 12, the reports and communications from city officials. The first is city manager's items which require action. John, item one.
Thank you, Your Honor. The first item deals with area service agreement for the district restaurant for use of city-owned property on the Vaughan Mall for outdoor seating with alcohol service. The restaurant was previously approved as Pesce Italian Kitchen, and that was done in March of 2011. The old Pesce and now the district restaurant has private property that they've had outdoor seating on. They want to expand out to 500 square feet in the Vaughan Mall pedestrian way. And the City Council did approve the pilot program for the use of this outdoor seating for alcohol service. What we're coming to the City Council tonight is to just ratify that because of the change in ownership, that the City Council is okay with moving forward with the district restaurant under the same terms and conditions that Pesce Italian Kitchen had. They would have the same restrictions that we voted on before.
You understand the requested action. Does anyone care to make a motion?
So moved.
Second.
Thanks, Councilor Smith and Assistant Mayor Novelin Clayburg. Discussion. Hearing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
None opposed, that is unanimous. Item two.
The next item, I'd like to have the deputy city manager come down and speak to regarding a report back on Cloud Drive, Traffic and Safety Committee action sheets of April 14th, 2011. She followed up on this matter for the City Council at its May 2nd meeting.
Welcome, deputy city manager.
Good evening, all. As you know, this was the one item from the Traffic and Safety Committee minutes that was not passed, and basically not passing that had the effect that it could remain on a short-term basis for the hour a day, 45 minutes, in its one-way fashion. So that was held off to the side while city staff went out, met with school department, police, fire, public works, and took a look at what the issue was there on Cloud Drive and the best way to get kids safely from the main street, South Street, down to the school. And basically there is enough room between the back side of the sidewalk and the fence for the ball field to add some additional pavement. So you'll have roughly 10 feet of pavement, 10, 11 feet, it varies in width from the curb line to the ball field fence. So you'll just have this asphalt path that is wider, one side for pedestrians, one side for bicyclists coming and going to school, and traffic would continue, if the council goes in the direction of the recommendation, traffic would continue to be two-way at all times of the day. And this was, in fact, a recommendation out of the Safe Routes to School report that was completed in 2010 to look at widening that sidewalk to up to 12 feet.
Thank you for that explanation. Do we have a motion?
So moved.
We have a motion to accept the report back as regarding? Okay. We have a second discussion. Councilor Dwyer.
Just a question. It sounds like a good solution. I know normally we try to, in fact, I believe it is illegal to ride your bicycle on the sidewalk. So how will we be demarcating that so that we're not kind of instilling a bad behavior?
You mean dividing pedestrians from the
right.
bicycle? I believe that the intent of the Public Works Director is to basically put in a white fog line to separate pedestrian and bicyclists.
And bicycle.
Because, as you probably know, the bicycle-pedestrian collisions are the highest fatalities related to bicycles.
Sure, and remember, these are little kids on bikes.
I know, and they're not riding fast.
And I believe they certainly have the option to walk their bikes from that from South Street in, and I believe that is done at times as well.
Further inquiry, discussion, comments? Thank you. All in favor?
Aye.
None opposed? It's unanimous. Item 3.
Thank you, Your Honor. The next item is Planning Board report back on the City Council referral regarding rezoning of land between Bartlett Street and the U.S. Route 1 bypass. We have a report back from Rick Tainter regarding the request from JSK Realty Trust for rezoning of land in question. On March 17, 2011, the Planning Department was notified that JSK no longer wished to pursue the rezoning, and there's an attached letter from Attorney Pelich dated May 17th. So in that event, the Planning Board voted to recommend the City Council take no action on the request for rezoning.
Move to accept the Planning Board's report back.
Second.
Thank you. We have a motion. We have a second. Discussion. Hearing none, all in favor?
Aye.
None opposed? That is unanimous. Pardon me? One abstention, please.
Thank you, Ron. The next item deals with the Planning Board report back on City Council referral, letter from John Shagnon, Ambit Engineering, regarding acceptance of land in conjunction with a subdivision located off of Kearsage Way. If you recall, on April 4th, the City Council meeting, the Council referred the request from John Shagnon, Ambit Engineering, regarding the acceptance of land in connection with the subdivision off Kearsage Way to the Planning Board for report back. At its meeting of May 19, 2011, the Planning Board voted unanimously to grant final subdivision approval to the subdivision and to recommend to the City Council vote to accept the land shown as Lot A, and there's an attachment there, there's a map, subject to an agreement to be approved by the legal department regarding operation and maintenance of the stormwater management system. So basically, the motion would be to accept a report back from the Planning Board on this matter.
Does anyone care to make a motion?
So moved.
Second.
Thanks. Motion in accordance with requested action. Thank you for the second. Discussion. Hearing none, all in favor?
Aye.
None opposed? It's unanimous.
Thank you, Your Honor. The next item deals with a report back on the Connie Bean Center, the sale of the Connie Bean Center. And at its meeting of May 19, 2011, the Planning Board considered this matter, voted to recommend that the City Council dispose of the Connie Bean Center by sale or long-term lease. Before the City Council acts on this matter, I'm going to ask the City Attorney to speak to what has been referred to as restriction on the deed, because I think it needs to be clarified.
Yes.
City Attorney.
Some members of the community have contacted the City Administration requesting that this evening, prior to the Council vote, that the Council be reminded of a certain earlier action taken by the Council. On December 6, 2010, there was a discussion here about the restriction that the city manager talks about, and the council voted at that time that we should clear the property of the deed restriction. The deed restriction that that earlier council vote referred to is that in 1948, when the city acquired the property from the Army and Navy Association, there's a provision in the deed that says that the property needs to be used for recreational, educational, and civic purposes. Because of changes in the building codes, among other things, the continuation of that purpose in that building has become impossible. The building is held as a charitable trust, and when the performance of a charitable trust becomes impossible, then the appropriate legal action to take is the filing of something called a cy-pray petition, Cypre in Latin means something like as near as possible. And what the Cypre petition would hope to do is to continue the purpose of the charitable trust, the building, as nearly as possible as can be done. So pursuant to the council vote of December 2010, what the city legal department has done is prepare a Cypre petition, forward it to the Attorney General's office in Concord because they oversee all charitable matters, and sought the assent of the Attorney General's office to sell the building, but in a way that will take the proceeds and Cypre use them as nearly as possible for some kind of a recreational, educational, or civic purpose. Just today, coincidentally, the Attorney General's office has advised us that they agree with the petition that was filed in response to the City Council vote, and we'll be proceeding with that Cypre petition. It will have the effect of removing that restriction from the title to the property so that the City Council will then be free to take whatever action it chooses with regard to leasing or selling the property.
Thank you for the explanation. Attorney Sullivan, any questions for him regarding this or any discussion in general? I don't think at this point we've had a motion, have we?
No, Your Honor, what we would need is just to accept the Planning Board's report back. Before we move forward, obviously, we're not going to run out and put a for sale sign on the Connie Bean after this vote, but this is just part of the process. We'll be coming back to the City Council and probably have to have a work session on how we want to deal with this issue. This just really gets us through a step that's required.
Thank you.
So accept the report. Council
Dwyer.
Move to accept the report.
Yes.
Second.
Moved, seconded. Discussion. We have representation that it'll be back before us, and we will make sure that it is docketed and we have an opportunity to discuss it. Any further discussion? Hearing none, all in favor?
Aye. Aye.
None opposed, that is unanimous.
Your Honor, next time I'd like to have Dave Allen come down to talk about the memorandum of agreement regarding the Great Bay Estuary Study. If you recall, the City Council had asked us to work with proactively to deal with the nitrogen issue that has affected our development of our wastewater treatment plant and some of the issues surrounding that, where we are working with multiple towns. We formed a coalition, and I'd like to, Dave, talk about what this is all about and the cooperation we're getting with the ES to enter into this.
Welcome, David.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor, members of the council. As the city manager mentioned, this is really a cooperative agreement that includes not only the six communities that are listed here, but very closely with DES. And I think what the positive thing that we're taking out of this is the fact that DES recognizes that there are holes in the science. After, you know, being badgered by Peter for the last 6 months, they actually understand the community's point of view that we can't just take a limit of technology, that there are some scientific reasons to go forward with a study. And this agreement would establishes a kind of a bit of a quid pro quo, that we will do the study, we will do some of the science, the modeling, the communities will fund that, we will share the information with DES, and in turn they're going to commit to going with an 8 milligram per liter limits on the plants as opposed to the 3 milligrams, and striving to convince with the information that we gather from this, the EPA, to go that route also. So, you know, we'll be doing the science. I think this science is not only effective in what we feel proving our point that the 8 milligram per liter limit would be a reasonable limit, but it's also a foundation that as we go to really establish what the issues are at the in the Great Bay, it will provide a lot of information that will help us really determine the long-term fix to move forward with. So you know, the communities have been very closely involved with this. Three have already voted, one's voting tonight. This document was actually put together very closely by the commissioner of the DES, so we feel that we're really coming up with a cooperative solution here.
So, Your Honor, what we basically would need to just have the City Council approve the memorandum of agreement as submitted and authorize the city manager to execute this agreement.
So moved.
Second.
Thank you, Councillor Smith. Councillor Assistant Mayor Novelyn Kleber. Councillor Kennedy.
What is the cost of this?
$50,000 per community.
Councillor Kennedy, you still have the floor if you wish.
I'll leave it at that.
Okay. Councillor Caviello.
Has there been any conversation with the Conservation Law Foundation?
Actually, we did. We received a document today that indicates that they're willing to, that they've been in conversations with some members from the UNH staff, and that there seems to be an outreach from this, that they're interested in coming up with a more of a cooperative agreement in understanding the science. And so this is the first time we had actually heard that there is some sort of some sway on their part, that we really do need to get good information before we start making these expensive decisions.
Anything further? Okay, Councillor Dwyer.
Admittedly, this is a little challenging to read if, you know, this is not part of your everyday stuff, but it seemed to me that so much of this is about modeling, really, in the Squamscott area and the and Exeter's challenges right now. And so if you could just, I mean, I followed that in the paper, and so I kind of understand that. But the first set of the modeling that's going to occur over the coming year is really related to that part of the watershed, right? Is that right? And then
more specifically, yes.
And so will we need then additional phases to do other parts of the watershed?
There could be additional phases. I suspect that there may be, but really this, you know, once you get the model built, this is the first effort is always the most difficult, and certainly some of the modeling that gets done on this gets, you know, you can transfer some of the information.
But then we would have to apply, I assume, we would have to apply to various parts of the watershed, because you just couldn't assume.
It appears that Peter wants to get up and maybe say a couple words. Peter, do you have something you want to offer?
He can read your body language better than I can.
Sorry,
Peter,
yeah.
So.
I was twitching a bit.
Yeah, I'm sure you were.
The model is really the backbone for looking at the entire watershed. And so it's really the first step in the whole process. And it's what's critical here is that DES has acknowledged the science needs to be improved on. And that before, in the memorandum agreement, it says before permit limits are finalized, that the science needs to be done. And that's really what we're getting the DES to commit to,
okay,
is that they
the
need to do additional work.
Okay.
Councillor Kennedy.
In looking at Table 1, and this is kind of what's perplexing me, I understand that DES published Table 1. Am I correct on that?
That's correct.
All right, on Table 1, I was kind of amazed at the number of serious impairments that are on that. And so where do they stand in their philosophy or their backing of the table and how they're involved in this process with us?
Well, I think that's the purpose of this, is to really get some better information so that these can be evaluated. I mean, that's the whole purpose of the study, is to get a better more information that can create a better model so those impairments can be better defined.
Okay. And so if this was created by DES, how does the EPA feel about it? So DES is saying this, and now what you're saying is DES is willing to take a step back.
Well,
let you guys do evaluation. Am I getting this right?
Right. Well, the process is the DES is responsible for a certain portion of information, and that information is the water quality of the receiving waters. And from that, EPA actually establishes a permit. So DES needs this information so that EPA can create its permit limit. So if this information isn't correct, then the EPA can't make, you know, can't set the limits correctly.
And so you're going to refute this information?
Potentially.
That's the goal.
That's correct.
All right, and what company are we hiring to do that?
Hydroqual is doing the...
Pardon?
Hydroqual is doing the modeling.
And what happens if it comes out worse, out of curiosity?
We don't feel it's going to come out worse. The evidence that we've already looked at indicates that it will come out in our favor.
I have a question.
Okay, Jerry Hitmonick.
I just want to congratulate the team getting the DES to agree to look at the signs. I think it's a major breakthrough, and it provides a real opportunity for the whole project to come in at a much better cost and end up with a much better project. So congratulations.
Councilor Spear.
If the EPA sets the limit based on the numbers provided by the DES, what is the meaning of the specifying the 8 milligrams per liter in the agreement between you, between us and the DES?
Well, that's, at this point, those other plants don't have, those permits haven't been issued. So it's an effort at this point.
At this point, all this is committing the city to do is look at what it would take to meet the 8 milligrams per liter. And that's the beauty of the way this is written. If you look at it, it only commits Exeter and Newmarket, which are up in the upper reaches of the estuary, to go to 8. What it says is that, you know, we need to look at it. And frankly, we've already done that as part of our master planning effort. So we're in a good position to, you know, comply with the requirements of this already.
Further inquiry or comments down this end? Councilor Spear.
But this isn't, like you said, this isn't specifying an upper or lower bound for our, we're forecasting that it would be higher than 8. Is that what you're saying? But at this point, it's, and we're, that's what we're going to work on. The EPA clearly believes that under their model, it would be 3, or limited technology, is what they have been suggesting.
And it's because they don't have better information.
Yeah. I see.
And that's what this is intended to do, get the information to defend a different limit on the treatment plants.
Very good.
Seeing no one venture forth to my left, Councilor Kennedy.
Where does this put, I mean, the time frame to get this information, where does this put us on the big picture of the wastewater situation?
This will be, you know, we're going forward. We've already begun our technology selection. We've taken some of the first steps in that direction. So it will really work concurrently. I mean, we'll be, you know, we needed to, at this point, our permit is for secondary treatment. So we knew, you know, we knew the different limits were out there, and we're cognizant of that, and we're keeping that in mind as we go through the technology evaluation. So this will actually work out well for us because the information will be done well before we've got our final selection.
Any further discussion or comments? Okay. Ready to vote with respect to the memorandum of agreement. Anyone, has it been moved? It has been moved and seconded. Thanks. Mm-hmm. Just checking. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Any opposed? None opposed. It's unanimous. Item 7.
Thank you, Right Honor. The next item deals with a proposal from Popovers, John Tinius, owner of Popovers. Could you pass that down, Bob? Regarding the alcohol service on city-owned property. In the, I did receive a letter from Mr. Tinius asking that it be withdrawn from the agenda. And then today at 1 o'clock, I received the email that I'm just passing out to you that asked that we reconsider. He is looking at, he would like to put in 10 tables and 40 seats as previously, as he said, previously approved by the city council. There would be no change in the grates and no impact on the trees. 2 outside containers for garbage and recycling, and bus buckets for dishes to accommodating a seating capacity of 40 seats. What I would say is that we have not seen his layout as of yet, and this came in, like I said, I haven't had an opportunity to review it. The council could act on this tonight, or could ask me to come back after we've reviewed it and bring it back for the June 20th meeting. He's also asking for a proration of the license, which is fine. I think it's a fair ask, given it's a pilot program, and that by the time he gets started, it'll probably be July, August, September, you know, probably stopping at the end of September. So I would, the council can do either or. Give me the authority to go forward. I have, like I said, I have not seen the layout specifically, or I can bring it back to you on the 20th with more of a review from city staff.
Councilor Kennedy.
I make a motion that we send it to the city manager for review and report back.
Second.
20th.
June 20th?
Yeah.
June 20th. And I'd like to comment.
We have a motion. Do we have a second?
Second.
Councilor Kennedy.
I still think that the trees need to be part of it. And the other thing I find quite interesting in this email is that he's resubmitting it on behalf of others. At least that's why I'm reading it, and not on. And I, so the question would be, is the sincerity from the owner?
Well, I'll talk to him.
Because it says I'm resubmitting because of request of certain people, and it doesn't really say he's resubmitting on his own interest. So I would like to know the sincerity of his wanting to do this for the pilot.
Okay. Further discussion? Councilor Smith.
Thank you. I would have supported it if we went forward with it tonight or have it next one. Reason being is, since it is a pilot program, it's going to be an influx, just as we've handled valet parking in the around the community, where the city manager has the power to make changes on the fly. That's why it's a test pilot program. So I'll be supporting the motion, but I would have supported it if we were going to move action on it tonight.
Further discussion?
Not. I'd like to pass the gavel.
Mayor Farini.
I would like to say that the letter before you indicates we are resubmitting our request for outdoor alcohol service at Popovers at the request of Doug Bates from the Chamber of Commerce, Mayor Tom Farini, and many regular customers and downtown merchants who feel that Popovers would be the perfect test for this pilot. I feel that in the interest of full disclosure, I did have a conversation with Mr. Tinios, and like I would say to anyone, if they wish to resubmit or negotiate with the city, they are more than welcome to do so. That does not mean that that is a particular endorsement. I think there are a number of merchants and or purveyors of food and so forth that could do this in an appropriate fashion. And indeed, I would not have supported it this evening because I did not believe it was properly before us. So it will come back before us for further discussion. And indeed, I would want to be assured that whoever makes such an application would do so in an earnest and appropriate fashion. Any further discussion? Hearing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
None opposed? It's unanimous.
Thank you, Your Honor. Those are all the action items I have, and I do have just some items under informational for your review, and I would be available for questions if there are any.
There you have it from the city manager. Questions for John? Hearing none. Councilor Spear.
This isn't a question, but this is a comment. The council will be discussing the Worth Lot parking garage in 2 weeks. I won't be here, but I wanted to pass on that the parking strategies that the council determines, and strategy being not tactics, but long-term strategy for how we want to handle parking, curbside, garage, and things like that, are fit hand in glove with what the planning board is considering doing in terms of land use and parking requirements for different types of uses downtown. And so I want you to take a look at the letter. I think you if you have any questions, you should work through the city manager and the planning director in terms of think about some ideas, because the planning board is really going to be looking forward properly toward the city council in terms of leadership, in terms of what direction we want to go in as a council, and we'll react after we have more council discussions on parking strategies. That's all.
Thank you, Councilor Spear. Any further discussion with the city manager? If not, we'll move on to the mayor's portion of the agenda. We have appointments to be considered, that those of Richard Katz for reappointment to the HDC, Nancy Beach for reappointment to the Cable Television and Communications Commission, Stephen Berg for reappointment to the Portsmouth Housing Endowment Fund Advisory Board, and those are before you for consideration for voting. I'm requesting votes in support of the appointments, reappointment of Christy Cardoso to the Citywide Neighborhood Committee, and Kathleen Burr-Siegel as reappointment to the Recreation Board.
So moved.
Second.
Moved and seconded. Discussion? Hearing none. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. None opposed? It's unanimous. Councilor Smith.
Thank you. I'd like to make a motion to accept the Parking Committee meetings of our meeting that was held May 12th. If I can have a second.
Second.
Thank motion you. Duly seconded. Councilor Smith.
There's nothing in here that's going to require an ordinance change. There is a pilot program in here, again, for valet parking along Bow Street for the Surf restaurant and the Wellington Room. And, of course, it's a to get a report back in 30 days. I mean, excuse me, for 6 months. But we get a 30-day interim report in there as well. Any questions? I'm happy to answer.
Questions for Councilor Smith? Okay, discussion. The motion is before you. Any discussion or comments? Hearing none, ready to vote. All in favor of the motion to accept and approve?
Aye.
Aye.
One abstention? In opposition. My apologies. In opposition. And there it is. It passed 8-1. We now move on to item 13, miscellaneous and unfinished business. If there is anything anyone would like to bring forward at this time, Councilor Spear.
I forgot my shirt. I wanted to bring it this morning. We had a great groundbreaking. The mayor was there. It went really well. The students did a good job. So we're well on our way to building the new middle school.
Well, well said by Joint Building Committee member along with Councilor St. Monica and Councilor Dwyer. They've been hard at work and done a great job, and it indeed was a real positive event for the community. That's, I'm glad you mentioned that. Any further discussion about anything at this time?
Move for adjournment.
Thank you, Councilor Smith. We have a motion to adjourn.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
None opposed? It's unanimous. It was seconded. Thank you. And good night.